Thank you. That's so awesome.
Yes.
So, hi, Rachel. Nice to meet you. You have extraordinary taste, by the way.
I know.
She's pretty awesome.
Never mind.
Come on in. Once we get everybody inside, we'll introduce our tour guide for the day. We're going to do a little bit of outside time and a little bit of inside time, but you're going to hear a lot of really cool stories while we're here, and I think you're going to love it. This is our friend John Rudy. John is one of our amazing National Park Service park rangers. He is an interpretive guide extraordinaire, although I think I could say that about most of the park rangers that work for the Park Service. They are all fantastic, at least the ones that we have, and I've never had a bad experience with it. So if you wonder sometimes in this political climate, like there's talk about what do we do with our tax dollars, supporting national parks, history, National Endowment for the Humanities, that kind of thing, this is some of what it goes toward, and it's really, really awesome. So people like John can share with us history about things that are really important to us and our tradition and our history, so there you go.
Hey guys, how's it going? Cool. How many of you have been here before? Okay, like two. Yeah, and the two that I
the
expect. Yeah, exactly. So, welcome. Well, how many of you have been to Harpers Ferry before? Okay, that's more hands than I would expect. Why haven't you come up here before? Now, that's a real question. Why haven't you come up here before?
Didn't know it was here.
Yeah. What was the answer over here?
Didn't know it was here.
Didn't know it was here. Okay. Mm-hmm. Didn't know it was here. What else?
I've ran by on the half marathon.
Okay. You ran by on the half marathon. That's kind of cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I didn't know it was a college.
Gotcha.
Or what?
I don't live here.
You don't live here? Yeah. So it's not in your brain, right?
And I think also because a lot of people think that they can't. They think that it's like all just administrative buildings and that you're not allowed to be here or that it's super secret.
Well, we are administrative buildings, technically. Mm-hmm. And they're putting some kind of weird lock system on the doors that I'm angry about. Mm-hmm. So you're gonna have to buzz yourself in, but you're all welcome to come on back, and you're all welcome to bring friends back and geek out over this history whenever you want, because this is your building, and this is your park. So welcome to Storer College, and it's a really cool place, and you are among a sliver of Harpers Ferry visitors that get to visit this place. Not because they don't want to, but because literally no one knows it's here. And you are coming in the best year possible. Because, actually, just saying, let me check the date. Yeah, you're coming the best week possible. Because this is Founders Day week.
Really?
Of Storer College on the 150th anniversary of Storer College.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Wow.
Congratulations. Storer College popped up here in 1867. 150 years. Real easy math this year. I love it when that happens. And Storer College was created as a Band-Aid on a wound, an American wound. And that's what I want to talk about today, our American wounds and the wounds that we inflict on each other, because that's what history is a lot of. And I also want to get to know you guys a little bit, and you to know each other a little bit, although you've been in class, so you know each other somewhat. But I want to talk about today and the past, because it's useless to talk about history. History's boring. History's a bunch of dead people and dates. But what history can tell us about what we do tomorrow is extremely interesting. So as we wander around this building, I want to share with you stories of things that happened here, people who fought here, people who suffered here, and people who overcame here. And that's really what this place is about. Cool? Awesome? Okay. We have a special exhibit on display right over here around the corner, and I want to show you something really cool in that exhibit. Come on.
Sorry, I didn't block your view.
Yeah.
Yeah.
and we'll be able to file by it and kind of get to see it a little bit. So it's the 150th, so we got lots of cool stuff out in the building. And lots of stuff that folks don't necessarily get a chance to see. I didn't know some of this stuff existed until Michelle, who's down in curatorial here at the park, brought this stuff out and put it in the case. Now just to explain a little bit when I say here in the park, I don't work for Harpers Ferry National Historical Park, which is a little weird. I work for the Washington office. So I work for every park, which also is a little weird. My job is I'm a trainer that trains park rangers how to be park rangers. I train park rangers how to tell cool stories and how to help you tell your cool stories too. And that's really what we do inside this building as a training center. That means I sit at a desk a lot and I get bored. I'm building PowerPoints, and then you have to kick open a web browser every so often to just get your eyes off of that. You know how that is? You gotta check Facebook. One of the things I always do is I check eBay, and I have an eBay alert up for Storer College, so please don't bid against me. I have an eBay alert up for Storer College. And I was doing this eBay alert, and something popped up in my email, and I click on the link. And it was, somebody mentioned Storer College in a description of a photograph. And actually, the photograph was mislabeled. So it wasn't taken by a Storer College student, because if it had been, I would have bid like $50 on it to buy it. It was like at 2 when I saw it. But it wasn't. It was just the wrong thing that got copy and pasted wrong. But I sent the seller a note saying, is this a Storer College photo? Because if it is, I want it. If it's not, I'm not interested. And she said, oh crap, I copy and pasted the wrong thing. I'm sorry. Are you interested in Storer College stuff? And I was like, yeah, I love Storer College stuff. I do Black History, I do Harper's Ferry. And she said, I've got this book that I've been trying to sell and I can't sell it to anybody. Do you know who would want to buy it? And it's this book right here. That is the register of the Free Will Baptist Church, which was across the street and was the religious institution that was tied to Storer College. That is the registration book for all the members. This is where the church kept minutes. And this is where you can basically start to piece together the Black community in Harpers Ferry in a way that we never could before that moment. And the Park Bookshop was able to scrape together some cash and buy it from her, and now it's in the Park Collection, which is awesome. And this just happened this year. And I love that book because it sat on this woman's shelf in her used bookstore for 10 years, unsold, because no one knew what it was, no one cared about what it was. And you never know what kind of treasures are kind of sitting there hidden. Well, she didn't know, but I knew, and you guys know. So I'm gonna take a second right now. Find somebody, maybe it's somebody you don't talk to very often in class or you don't see very often. Find somebody, pair up. Hey. I'm not kidding here. Pair up, find somebody to chat with.
Yeah.
Cool.
Hey.
Who's got a treasure that they figured out that they want to share with the big old group here? Oh, you're volunteering her. Do you want to share?
Yeah, go ahead. I have postcards that my brother used to send me when he was in the Navy, of like every place that he went to, and on the corner of them he would draw like a little sketch, and it was like a flip book whenever you put them all together, and I had them like hidden in my trunk.
That's so cool. It's so amazing.
I didn't have anything.
It's gotta be cool to you though.
Yeah.
Did you have anything fun? Anybody else have anything else fun they want to share?
Mine wasn't as fun, but mine was really meaningful. Is that my dad used to make dulcimers and play dulcimers, and so my friend John Lilly came from Charleston once and brought me this photo, and I opened it up. He's like, I've got a present for you, and I opened it up, and it was a picture of my dad playing lap dulcimer at Ripley, West Virginia, at Cedar Lakes, and I am probably 3 years old, and I'm standing beside him, this little toe-headed kid, and it's my dad. My dad doesn't play anymore because his arthritis is so bad, and he doesn't make instruments anymore, so as soon as I opened it, like, I started to openly, like, weep, and it's a moment, I didn't even know the photograph existed. It had been in the archives in Charleston at the Cultural Center, and he was going through old stuff at Golden Seal and was like, oh, I think this is Rachel's dad. And he didn't know it was me. He just knew it was my dad. So that hangs on the wall in my house. And it was really important to me.
Mine's kind of different, I guess. Mine is my really old, ripped up, taped up, beat up soccer cleats from my freshman year in high school.
Yeah.
And I guess they're so special to me because freshman year in high school, my teammate passed away in a car accident, and she was the one that kind of took me under her wing when I started. And so her name and number is on my cleats. Mm-hmm. So if anyone ever like touched them, I would.
It's precious, too.
Yes. But they smell really bad and they're really old, so
someone else will pass them, but you know.
Yeah.
It's cool.
Mine is
anybody else?
I have a score, a Don Giovanni score that I conducted from when I went over to Italy to try to make it, quote unquote. So it looks terrible. It's beat up and ripped from carrying it around the streets, and it's all marked up so people would think it was a mess, but it means a lot to me.
This building, to me, is one of those things. Because when you wander around this building, it is worthy of demolition. It's just an old, rickety building. I mean, the guys are putting in this new security system, and they're having to drill through solid walls of brick because it's just so weirdly built and poorly built and differently built and 1830s built. Mm-hmm. It's like, it's a building that doesn't matter. But once you put a layer of stories on it, like a layer of a story of a friend who you've lost, or a flipbook, when you put enough of those little pictures together, you know, when you put the lines on that page, when it's not just the score, but when you've got your pencil marks all over it, and you remember tapping the baton, that's when these things stop being just a stupid old building and start becoming something amazing. And I've got a moment like that. It's in this room. And it's right there. Okay, I'm going to have to close the door for a second, because so that everybody can see. There we go. And then we're going to go outside. Okay. Come on.
Yeah, come get close.
This is literally my favorite picture from the Civil War, so you got to get close. No, close. Come on. You're not going to hurt anybody. There you go. Okay.
There you go.
This picture, I printed it out this big so you can get this close, so you can see all these amazing details. This picture was taken right outside of this door in 1862. August of 1862. In the second week of August of 1862. I love when you can get that detailed. Figure out in a photograph, you go, oh my God, this is the exact moment this happened. This is from a photographic series done by Matthew Brady here in Harpers Ferry of the 22nd New York State Militia. But these aren't soldiers. He comes up here and he shoots pictures of men leaning on cannons. How many of you have seen Ken Burns, the Civil War? Yeah, that number's going down and down each year, and that's okay. Because there's lots of cooler and more awesome Civil War stuff that's come along. But it's all about pictures. And if you do get a chance to watch it, Ken Burns uses one of these pictures in every single episode of the thing because they're so perfect. He doesn't use this one. Because he's telling a very particular story of the war. He's telling the story of those soldiers leaning on cannons, the soldiers standing there with their guns or hanging around cooking. This photo in the series is unique. This photo is titled The Contraband of Company A of the 22nd New York State Militia. Contraband. Okay, to us today, that probably means, well, something like drug paraphernalia, right? You know, you're caught with contraband. Mm-hmm. That means that now you're not just going to spend some time in jail, you're going to spend a lot of time in jail. It's that kind of crap that happens. These are people known as contraband because of the rule of law. It's actually a moment of mercy. Before the Civil War, these folks had been held in chains. They're slaves. Some of them are probably from Virginia. You're standing in Virginia in 1862. They haven't gone very far. Some might be from North Carolina. Make a trip up from Tennessee. Make a trip up from Georgia, even this far, to find freedom. Before the war, they were seen as property in the South. Human chattel property. And in 1862, they had become something more, while remaining exactly the same thing. There's an officer in the war, year before, a man named Ben Butler. Butler was a lawyer, and he's smart. Three men come to his fort down in Southern Virginia. They knock on the door, and they say, "We want to be free." Ben Butler says, "Come on in, sure, whatever." These three black men were slaves. Ben Butler interviews them, finds out that they've been being used to build fortresses outside of Hampton Roads. And he goes, "Aha, now I have my in. I'm going to use the South's laws against them." So when their master comes to retrieve them from the fort, he's a Confederate. He comes to a federal officer and says, hey, can I have my folks back? And Ben Butler says, no. You see, these folks you call property. And the rule of law says that during a war, if you're using property, say a gun or food, to support the war effort, I can use my army and seize it. And I can use that property how I want. And then Ben Butler says, "You call these folks property. Mm-hmm. That means I can seize them as contraband of war." They're not free. But it's a first taste of freedom. It's a first moment where you go, I am not beholden to somebody else. These folks, if you notice the clothes they're wearing here, you see it? This right here, he kind of looks like a soldier, doesn't he? Mm-hmm. He's got the typical slouch cap on. This kid right here, I love him. He shows up in a couple other pictures. He's obviously a manservant to an officer. He's wearing Zouave pants, which are French-style soldier pants, and he's wearing a fez with a tassel on it. And those don't match each other, but they're from different units, which tells me that his officer has probably traded for some clothes or bought some special clothes for him and given them to him. These folks are earning some of the first wages they've ever gotten in their lives. They're getting issued some of the best clothes they've ever worn on their backs. They're getting food, and they're getting a promise of freedom. When this war is over, because everyone knows what it's about, when this war's over, you'll be free. By the fall of 1862, there are 5,000 men, women, and children who have run to Harpers Ferry for freedom. 5,000 people. And they all look like that right there. You wanna go stand where they're standing? Mm-hmm. Okay, let's go outside. I know, we're gonna have to weirdly swing the door. Right there. You can stand right there. You want to sit in their footsteps. Stand right here.
So if that picture like, is 1862 here, and the college didn't start till 1867, what was this building?
I'm getting there.
Okay.
I'm getting there.
Okay.
So when they are standing here, only part of this building that was standing were, in architecture speak, these three bays, okay? Window, door, window, up to the second floor. That's all that was here, plus a dependency off the side of the building. And this, before the Civil War, is the Federal Armory Superintendent's house. This is where the boss of the gun factory lives. He lived here in 1859 when John Brown struck. His name was Alfred Barber. He lived here with his wife, with his kids, and with his five pieces of human property as well. Gets a little more interesting now, doesn't it? Because this building and this hill, by 1862, has already transformed. It's already transformed from a place where slaves were held in bondage to a place that slaves see as a beacon of hope. And they were standing right here. Right where we are. You can step back in time if you want to and see them and meet them and shake their hands. But their journey is not over. Well, those folks, they get out. The 22nd New York State Militia leaves town at the end of August. But by September, Robert E. Lee's army is invading Maryland, pushing into the north. And with them come the orders to capture any property that is deemed valuable to the army. Lee is coming north to grab the last of the supplies that are in the fields. He's pushing north to grab the fruitful harvest in September. And he's also pushing north to capture human beings and send them back to Richmond and sell to help fund the war effort. Harper's Ferry is a thorn in this side. There's 12,500 men here. And if he wants to go any further north than we are right now, he needs to get rid of them. Why? Right? Why? Okay, so you are Robert E. Lee. Okay? March north. Ha ha! I got your back. Boom. See what can happen? If I'm standing behind her, I can take her. He can't leave any enemy in his path, so he needs to get rid of Harper's Ferry. So he sends Stonewall Jackson here to capture the garrison. They're gonna close it in and crush it. And 12,500 men are captured. And under the rules of war at that point in time, they are sent, these are federal soldiers, United States soldiers, are sent to a United States prisoner of war camp. Because basically the idea is, you got your guys, and I got my guys. I don't want to feed your guys. You don't want to feed my guys. So it's like a big game of dodgeball. You have your jail over there, I have my jail over here. And when somebody catches a ball, we go tag, you're in, and we can throw in men on both sides. They end up in prisoner of war camps. But there's 5,000 people here beyond those 12,000. And those men, women, and children get dragged back south. 22nd New York State Militia has to leave behind some of the men that are sick in the unit. They use this building as a hospital. They're upstairs in the garrison place. And one of them afterwards says that it was literally the worst day of his war. Now think about what that means. These are men who fought through the Civil War for about 3 years. They saw combat. They saw their friends killed sitting next to them. They buried bodies. They ate shit. I mean, think about that. This is the worst day of the war. So imagine the worst day of your life. That's what this is. He's laying in bed, he's sick, he has diarrhea, and outside his window, he hears screams as women are torn from their children. As husbands and wives are ripped apart and sent south. Right where we're sitting. Civil War, this is a landscape that needs healing. And America needs healing. After the war's over, those 4 million or so Americans who had before been called property are now called citizens. But African Americans after the war, it's a hard row to hoe. Because for 30 years, if you are black and you were a slave, you were denied the right to learn how to read and write. Now, if I free you tomorrow, what can you do? You can't read a contract to get a job. You probably can't do the math to make sure your paycheck has enough cash in it. You can't sign a bank loan because you can't even sign your name. You can't write down your story.
You can't petition your member of Congress to serve. No, you can't serve in Congress. Because you kind of have to read those bills in order to vote. This is crucial. And it's when places like Storer College step in. So now we can go down to that end of the building. Because now we're going to build that end. So come on. The Free Will Baptist Missionary Society, a group of white religious folks from New England who have too much cash on their hands, go, we want to do something good. We want to do something right. Let's start a school. Let's help the former slaves to learn how to read and write. So they send cash down here, and they apply for grants. This is my favorite little detail. They are grant writers. Just like every good historian today, they write grants to get free money. And the free money they apply for is from the Freedmen's Bureau. It's an office of the federal government that is set up explicitly to send money out to lift up the men and women who had been in bonds. The Freedmen's Bureau puts $8,000 in, the Free Will Baptist Church puts $8,000 in, wham, Storer College is born. That moment, it's not Storer College, it's Storer Normal School. And it was originally headquartered down at that end of Fillmore Street. You can't see the building even when the trees have no leaves on them, unfortunately. Although, someday I'm going to come down with a chainsaw and just cut like a hole through there so I can point to it. The first home is up at the end of the cemetery. You wander down the street sometime and you come back to visit and see it. I'm not going to take you down and walk a mile just to see a building. They start down there and they're a normal school. Normal schools are special kinds of schools. Normal schools are teachers' colleges. Their idea is not just to teach men and women who have been denied the right to read how to read. They've got a cooler idea. They've got a more Free Will Baptist idea. We're gonna teach folks how to read and write. I teach you how to read, okay? Awesome. It's a great skill and it helps you. Now I'm gonna go the second one. I'm going to teach you how to teach other people how to read and write. Cool. Now you're a teacher. Okay, go over there. Teach those folks over there how to read and write. They're awesome. Can you teach them how to teach other people how to read and write? Awesome. Can you guys spread over this way? You see this? This is learning as a virus. So now you're teaching them how to read and write, you're teaching these guys how to read and write, and you're teaching them how to teach other people how to read and write, so they're spreading out. This is how we fix a problem extremely quickly. And so Storer College is one of the perfect antidotes to the problems that came before the American Civil War. And it's such a perfect antidote that it needs to continue growing. And one building is not enough. They start looking for empty buildings and they start working their way up the street. And luckily, because this was a federal town before the war, there was a gun factory here. Because this was a federal town before the war, there's lots of abandoned federal property. So they start applying to the government, again, for grant-style things. This time they're going, hey, you got this building here? Nobody's in it, it's falling down. Can we take it over and at least fix it up a little bit so it doesn't fall in on itself? And the government says, sure, whatever. Just do whatever you want with it. It's fine. They do that a couple times up the street until finally they get to the master armor's house. Or, I'm sorry, the superintendent's house. And they say, that building right up there on the top of the hill, we really like that one. Can we have that one too? And the government says, we're not doing anything with it. We're not going to rebuild a gun factory on a floodplain. So sure, we can do something with it. They take over the building, and then they expand it. If you come over here, you can see exactly when they do expand it. 1881. Cornerstone for this building, and when this becomes the heart and soul of Storer College, Anthony Hall. This is it. This is home. For nearly a century, this place sends forth educated young black men and women into the American South to destroy ignorance. And you are at the epicenter of that revolution. Okay, not the only epicenter, because there's places like Tuskegee and Hampton and Howard. There's tons and tons of HBCUs. But this is ours, which makes it kind of cool. This is Jefferson County's HBCU. This is West Virginia's, well, Panhandle West Virginia's HBCU. This is the place where we start healing that wound. Share with your new buddy, what is one wound you see in our society today that you think needs some healing? Does anyone want to share one of the wounds you see that we've got to heal in society?
We said that these days it's not celebrated to be different. A lot of times being different is seen as a scary thing or like a threat to order. And so a lot of times society tries to make you conform to normal, and that's not a positive thing. Because different is good, you know, in many different ways.
That ring true with anybody?
Mm-hmm.
I've seen some shaking heads, yeah. Anybody else have something like that?
Okay. What I said was, I think that we're afraid to actually step out of our comfort zones. We're actually afraid to, you know, be connected to somebody from a different background, or, you know, from a different perspective of life. So we kind of just stay to what we know and not really try to branch out and actually meet other people.
I said respect. The concept of respect, respecting each other, has gone down in value the last, you know, 1,500 years. So, and then when you respect each other, that's been more important. So.
It sounds like that respect is tied to the understanding difference, is tied to the kind of stepping outside of comfort zones.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else see any other ones that you recognized?
Well, I said racism because I don't think that based on bloodlines, I mean, all the mixing that has happened, the majority of the people came from England or Africa or wherever you came from. There's no real way that you can look at anybody else and say that who I am is better than who you are because of what color or nationality I identify with. Because in all actuality, if you look at the inventors of things and if you look at the creators of things, it came from a lot of different people. There's a lot of different things that white people made that we need. There's things black people made that we need. So there's all nationalities. We all need everybody. And because this nation is such a melting pot, nobody has the right to say that except the Native Americans. You know?
Yeah.
You know, the only people that can say, you don't belong here, because everybody else was either came here on their own or were forcibly brought here. So, you know, there's nobody that can say, you know, I see a lot of, well, if you don't like this, leave, or if you don't like that, leave. And I think that's really, really not something that anybody, any of us, can say to anyone.
Agreed.
Good answer.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm hearing a lot of
right-ons.
Yes. Yeah. We got right on right
now. What other kind of wounds do we see?
I have one. Mine was specifically our education system. Really, because growing up in this area, I never learned about this. And I'm, like, thinking back, and I don't learn, and kids don't learn about cultures other than their own, particularly. Like, we don't learn about other countries or what's happening. Like, if we learn about, just to say, like, for one specifically, we learn about a lot of black history in February, but not the rest of the year, not a lot of cultures throughout the rest of the year. So I just really think that would help. Like, if you know and you understand other people and other cultures and what they've been through, then it's much more likely that you're going to be accepting and open to other things. So, that was mine.
How many of you went to school around here? I mean, you're going to Shepherd now, but How many of you heard in school about this place that, that went to? A couple of you? A lot of you shook your head no, though. It's amazing when you scratch the surface and you find a new story, the type of people you could find. Now, in the 1930s, in Harpers Ferry, now 1920s and 30s, let's go upper level history here. That's the nadir of civil rights in America. Nadir means the bottom of the trough, okay? It is the lowest point for civil rights in America, for African Americans. Here in Harpers Ferry, there's folks that have to fight back against institutions that are trying to codify in the landscape their social status. Okay, that's fancy talk. What do I mean? They're trying to build monuments that say that black folks are not equal to white folks. United Daughters of the Confederacy. United Daughters of the Confederacy decide they need to put up a monument. They need to put up a monument, and they create a committee to plan this monument. And the name of the committee is the Loyal Slave Committee. Nothing like reading in your conclusion before you start your study, right?
Yeah.
And they go, we need to find, in the historical record, a slave who was loyal to the Confederacy. Now, they're doing this for a very political purpose at that moment in time. It's the bottom of the trough of civil rights. The Klan has been reborn in America. Lynching is a daily event across the South and across the North. Segregation is riding high everywhere in the country. They're trying to reinforce the narrative, trying to insert themselves into that narrative. So they create this monument. They find that black person. They find that loyal slave, or at least the closest they can get to it. His name is Hayward Shepherd. And in 1859, when John Brown struck here in Harpers Ferry, John Brown, an abolitionist who struck violence in Harpers Ferry to destroy the institution of slavery, Hayward Shepherd called the police. Now, to be fair, Hayward Shepherd probably didn't know what was going on. Hayward Shepherd was the baggage handler. He was a free man down in town at the local train station. And when a bunch of guys come into town at 10 o'clock, dressed in floppy hats and floppy shirts with guns saying, we're taking over, he freaks out, runs across the bridge, and he's headed to the telegraph station opposite Harpers Ferry in Maryland. He wants to get a telegraph off to anywhere to say our town is under attack. I mean, it's what you do, right? You see something happen in the street, you pick up the phone, and you dial 911. Hey, there's something going on. Can you guys come over and handle it? You don't go, why exactly are you fighting you? Okay, what is your moral purpose behind this fight? Right? You just go, no, something weird is going on here. I need to report this. John Brown's men see the figure of someone, anyone, running to alert the authorities. They level their guns and they fire. And the first person killed during John Brown's raid is a free black man.
Wow.
And it's this weird irony of history. It's that wow moment. And the United Daughters of the Confederacy in the 1930s go, wow. And they decide to use this. And they create a boulder. You can visit down in town, the Hayward Shepherd Monument. And then they have to dedicate that monument. And they decide to dedicate it on the anniversary of John Brown's raid in 1931. And to that dedication, they invite the students of Storer College, the entirely black student body of Storer College. Now we sit here and go, wow, okay. This does not sound like it's that great of an idea for the students to show up to this. They actually invite the college president to give a speech to welcome them to Harpers Ferry, and they invite the college choir to sing. The college choir, they want to have gospel tunes sung at this dedication. And one woman in the college faculty stands up. She says, no. And I want to take you to her choir right now. Come on.
Outside of most professors' offices, though. Mm-hmm. Keep on coming in. We're about the size of the Storer College Choir. We'll fit. Well, there wasn't an elevator here, but we'll fit. Okay. We still got, are you guys back? Awesome. This is the choir room. Well, the elevator wasn't here, so it went all the way out to that end of the building, so it was a little bit longer. And this is where Pearl Tatton, the choir director, would hold rehearsals. You can actually, if you kind of squint your eyes, you can see her standing right here. In the choir over there, on risers. You can see her leading them in song. They sang Beethoven. They sang all sorts of different stuff, chorale, but they also sang gospel music. They sang for the church, Free Will Baptist services. They sang for the college chapel upstairs.
Thank you.
Because I'm tight, yes. They sang for everything the college did. This is an amazing little space, because this is a space that was probably one of the most joyful spaces on the campus. We have an elevator shooting through the center of it now, but I found this on a blueprint of the building and went, oh my God, I know where that is now. I went, that was another one of those moments where you go, a second ago, this was just where the elevator is. Now, this is where they sang. And this right here, this is the practice room and Pearl's office. So when she's not out here directing the choir, she's in here giving voice lessons, or she's in here sitting at her desk doing her work. And that's where she is in the fall of 1931, leafing through the black newspaper. Now, there isn't a large enough black population in Jefferson County to support a black newspaper for this area. In fact, there's not even a large enough population in West Virginia or Maryland or Virginia or Pennsylvania alone. So Baltimore creates the Baltimore Afro-American. It's the local black paper in Baltimore, but covers everything out here to the west, everything up to the north, up to the northern border of Pennsylvania, everything down into the Carolinas. The Mid-Atlantic is covered by this paper, and this is her news source. As she's flipping through, she sees an article about an event that her and her choir are going to be singing at. She looks down at the article, she reads it, and she comes upon the phrase Loyal Slave Committee, and she goes, no. Up to this point, she had been told, we're going to sing at a monument dedication hosted by the Daughters of the Confederacy down in town. It's a goodwill event. Mm-hmm. Now, she's starting to piece together why the monument's going in. Mm-hmm. And it's starting to ring a little bit harsh with her. So she sits down at her desk in here, and she writes a note. And then she takes out a pair of scissors and clips out that newspaper article and paper clips it to the note. And then she cuts a little piece of paper and writes President McDonald on the piece of paper, slides it under the paper clip, and walks down the hall.
Follow.
Eventually, we'll figure it out. Quickly. There you go.
Okay, we'll all fit in the choir room. We won't all fit in the president's office. And the president's office is now the women's room, so about half of us can't go in there. President Henry McDonald, who she writes this letter to, has been president of Storer College since the 19th century, since the 1890s. It's now 1931. It's a white dude, okay? That's the most important detail here. Pearl, 5 foot nothing, a tiny black woman, is standing up to the president of her college, a powerful local white man. And this is the note she writes. I love how the first thing she does, she lines out President McDonald's name on the letterhead, because it's not coming from him, it's going to him. Dear Mr. McDonald, after reading this article, I wonder if we should have a part in the exercises. When I talked with you, I did not see the attitude of the UDC. Do you think we should appear on such a program when we honor John Brown and feel that while he may have used the wrong methods, his motive was just? I feel now that should we take part, we would be most inconsistent. Sincerely, Pearl Tatton. Think about the gumption it takes to write that letter. This is your boss. This is your white boss. In what amounts to apartheid West Virginia, where segregation is understood, it's de facto law. In a country where black women are being lynched across the South for much less than this, she writes this letter. President McDonald goes, I understand. I tend to agree with you. The problem is we already RSVP'd. So if we pull out now, it looks bad. It looks really bad. Because now we're making a political statement by pulling out. So we can't. We have to go through with this. Pearl's been vetoed. Nothing she can do but take her students down and sing. So they go down. President McDonald gives the opening speech. He welcomes the UDC to Harpers Ferry. And then the president of the United Daughters of the Confederacy. And I love the fact that the newspaper doesn't even give the common courtesy of giving her a first name. She is Mrs. Leopold Bashinsky. Shows you exactly where she stands in society too. But she is one step above Pearl. Mrs. Leopold Bashinsky, her name's Elizabeth, stands at the podium and gives a speech in dedication of this monument. And she talks. She talks at length about how she loves the South, how she loves where she lives, how she loves her nation, and how she loves what the South has always been. And then she starts talking about growing up in the South and what it was like. And then she gives this couple of paragraphs on her black mammy. Oh, oh, my black mammy. How she loved me and how we loved her. How she took care of the chillens. Oh, the black mammy, she would never, never go against her master. She showed utter loyalty. Sitting on the rostrum behind this woman is Pearl Tatton and her entirely black choir, getting ready to sing Negro spirituals. You can almost feel Pearl's body shivering. They're up next. They gotta sing. Mrs. Bashinsky sits down. Pearl and her choir stand up. All they're supposed to do is sing. But Pearl turns around and walks over to the podium. And she addresses the crowd. I am the daughter of a Connecticut Yankee who fought for the same ideals that John Brown did, who fought against slavery in this war, who wore the blue uniform. And she is. Her father was Charles Tatton, who fought in the 29th Connecticut, a United States Colored Troops unit. He fought against the idea of the black mammy and everything it stands for. And we at Storer College, we are looking not to the past, but to the future. We are looking to raise young men and women who will rise up and overcome the legacy of the black mammy. And then Pearl turns on her heels, strikes up her choir, and they sing a spiritual. It's a song called Standing in the Need of Prayer. And it is a prayer of supplication, asking for forgiveness for when I have not asked forgiveness, and begging of you to ask forgiveness of your sins against me. It's like a knife in the side. It's like going, so you're gonna apologize now? Huh? Knife in the side. But think about when she's doing this, 1931. Women are lynched across the South for looking crosswise at a white person. She stands up and speaks directly at them. and tears them down. Somewhere in the crowd, someone takes out a pen, writes in the back of a program, sends a note up to the stage, and it gets handed to Pearl. How impertinent of you. You ruined the whole occasion. This was completely uncalled for. I don't understand why you did this. I have to imagine that Pearl's smiling when she's reading that one, because it's exactly the reaction she's looking for. She knows she hit her mark. And the black press, the Afro-American, they laud her as a hero. How many of you know or live or have been over in Frederick? Do you know the story of Barbara Fritchie?
Yeah.
Barbara Fritchie was supposedly an old woman in Frederick who, when the Confederates invaded in 1863, defiantly hung a federal flag, a United States flag, out her window and waved it in their faces. They call Pearl a modern-day Barbara Fritchie, waving the flag, the American flag, in the faces of these Confederates. She becomes a hero in the black community. Now, why the choir was there to begin with? The black community starts asking that question too. Mm-hmm. We've got a huge hero here, but Storer College has a huge problem. Mm-hmm. How are you making these decisions? And that problem comes home to roost the next year. Let's go out and look at that problem. I love looking at the faces in these pictures, because there is such hope embedded in this landscape. And we're standing in a location that was a place of hope in this landscape. In 1906, long before Pearl was standing up to the UDC, here to this campus came a group of men and women that called themselves the Niagara Movement. This is their second meeting. Their first meeting was in, anyone guess it? Niagara Falls. That's why they call themselves the Niagara Movement, so they decide to have their second meeting in Harpers Ferry. It makes perfect sense to them, though, because Harpers Ferry is where a white man stood up for black men. It's where we could come together as a society and where the fight, the actual fight, the violent fight for earning black rights started. When he comes to speak here, W.E.B. Du Bois is going to say, and he wrote a biography on John Brown, that this is a place that is sacred to African Americans. And now it's a school. Du Bois comes here with the Niagara Movement. They meet over the summer of 1906, and inside that building right there, and out in the front lawn because it's really hot, they decide to form a new society. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People. The NAACP was born right there. Du Bois has a deep root on this campus. They see something else, a remnant of that fight for rights, of that violent overthrow of the Confederate system, of the slave system, of the Southern system. John Brown, when he was here in town, was a small brick building that he used as a fortress. Well, by 1906, that fortress has been moved around a couple times. It actually was sent all the way to Chicago to be used as a pavilion at the World Columbian Exposition. And when it comes back, there's no place to put it. So they put it out in the middle of a farm field, about a mile that direction, and use it as a shed. Du Bois sees this and he goes, okay, wait a second. This is sacred ground. This is the place where our movement takes its heart, takes its soul. He gathers up these new members of the NAACP, formerly calling themselves the Niagara Movement. Now they have a cause. They march across the street and a mile into a cornfield and get to that building. And when they get there,
They march around it, singing John Brown's body, singing the battle hymn of the Republic. And then they take their shoes off in the middle of a farm field, and they walk inside the building because that is sacred ground and they need to show reverence. So sacred that in 1909, they decide that it doesn't belong in a farm field. It belongs on a college campus that is raising young black men and women to become the future of America. And they take that building down brick by brick and rebuild it right where we're standing. John Brown's fort stood right here. Du Bois has a huge influence on this place. But by 1932, he's also becoming a kind of political hot potato. America has changed a lot in the last 20 years. America has become a different place. And black society has changed a lot in the past 20 years. The Harlem Renaissance has happened. A black middle class is being formed. And a lot of smart HBCUs are stopping and saying, hey, we don't need folks like the Free Will Baptists anymore. We don't need the white folks to come down here and dump money into our coffers. We have plenty of alumni who are middle class, who write us checks every year. That's where our bread and butter is. That's where we can fill our endowment. Henry MacDonald has been president of Storer College since the 19th century. He's still president in 1932. He's a white dude. He's not changing with the times. He's most concerned about pissing off the white folks. So when W.E.B. Du Bois comes to him in 1932 and says, hey, okay, you screwed up last year. You screwed up last year with the Hayward Shepherd thing. We're gonna fix it. My society, the NAACP, has built a plaque. I wrote the text of it myself. We have paid to have it cast in bronze, and we are gonna come down to your college. We're gonna put it on the side of John Brown's fort. I like them apples. And MacDonald goes, no, you're gonna piss off all the white folks in Jefferson County. You're gonna get them on the wrong side of me, and then what am I gonna do? I'm not gonna be able to fund the place. And Du Bois comes back and says, do you realize what you're doing here? You realize the enemies you're making right here? And MacDonald goes to the board of trustees at the college, and they go, no, you're right. Don't put the plaque there. The NAACP comes to town in 1932 anyways. They were having their annual convention in Washington, D.C. They take a train out here for a special event. They ask the president to use the building. He's okay with that, just no plaque. They bring the plaque anyways. They sit it on a chair, and W.E.B. Du Bois gives a speech with the plaque sitting next to him for 20 minutes, excoriating Storer College as a turncoat to African-American society. And the black press eats it up. Because Du Bois says it, it's gospel. I don't blame him. The plaque told the truth. I mean, it told W.E.B. Du Bois's truth. But it told the truth. And it took until until 2006 before that plaque finally was put up on the landscape. This is the plaque, but it's not the plaque. They took the plaque back home. It sat in the basement of the New York headquarters of the NAACP for years, and then it disappeared. My supposition, my idea, is that it probably disappeared during World War II during a scrap drive. Makes the most sense why a giant hunk of metal would disappear. The NAACP cast a new one. They cast a new one and they approached the Park Service. They approached the Park Service and said, hey, okay. We know there was this screw-up in 1931, and then there was the second screw-up in 1932, but now we want to give you a chance to make up for it. So we would like to make a new plaque, use W.E.B. Du Bois's exact wording on that plaque, and we would like to bolt it to the side of John Brown's fort. which is exactly what Du Bois wanted to do with it. Bolt it to the side of the fort. And if we do that now, it makes a hell of a lot more sense because the fort is right across the street from the Hayward Shepherd Monument.
Yep.
So the two will speak to each other. This is your chance, Harpers Ferry National Historical Park, to make up for a historical wrong. And the park went, no.
Of course.
It's a historic structure. It's a historic structure, and we can't put any new monumentation on the side of a historic structure. And the NAACP went, wait. If we had put that plaque there in 1932, you picked the fort up on the back of a truck in 1966 and moved it downtown, it would be there. That's exactly where it would be. And the park went, okay, well, we'll let you put up the plaque, but not on the side of the fort. You can put it up at the historic site of the fort in 1932, which is right here. Here, John Brown aimed at human slavery a blow that woke a guilty nation. With him fought seven slaves and sons of slaves. Over his crucified corpse marched 200,000 black soldiers and 4 million freedmen, singing, John Brown's body lies moldering in the grave, but his soul goes marching on. You see what it says down there at the bottom too?
Yep.
In gratitude, this tablet is erected, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, May 21st, 1932. They have to use the exact wording used on the plaque. Not even acknowledge the fact that it was put here in 2006. I work for an agency that has a lot of problems. We have a hell of a lot of problems. And we make stupid decisions sometimes. And I'm hoping someday that this gets moved. Because every year, a group about your size are the only people that see it. Whether it's you guys or another group that I drag out here and say, hey guys, look at this. There's people that work inside that building. That is the design center for the entire National Park Service, where they design every exhibit that goes out and you see in a park visitor center that have probably never stopped and read this. But think of, if we bolted it to the side of John Brown's fort, how many people would stop?
Everybody.
And see the story, and hear the story, and feel that story. Feel a historical wrong being righted. But this is also a tombstone. This is the beginning of the death of Stora College. Because these two incidents push the college over the hill. And now, you have students that went here who don't acknowledge that fact. Who say, oh, yeah, I went to Stora College. But you know, after that I went to Howard, and Howard is my school. After Howard I went to Columbia. Columbia is my school. Stora, it's just like a high school. And they can't get the money. And they can't fill the endowment. And every year, the money just keeps going down and down and down and down. And something's eventually got to give. That something's going to give in 1954 and 1955. Let's head up back up to the building. Gold, by the way. School's colors are ivory and gold. So if you want to make a Stora College pennant or make a Stora College hat, or sweatshirt, you should go with ivory and gold. I'm still trying to figure out how to make my own. And I love having this stuff here because to me, I look in this case and it's like pieces of the true cross. They're like religious artifacts of a place that tried to do good and died a little bit too soon. 1954, a huge decision sits in front of the Supreme Court. Brown v. Board, the question of school segregation. And we know how that one turns out. The Supreme Court in Brown v. Board rules that segregation in schools is no longer allowed. And that is the moment that Stora College
needs to die. It started dying with that tombstone down there, but this is the final nail. By the 1950s, Storer College doesn't have an endowment left. There's no cash on hand. The way that they're paying the bills, the way that they're paying for the school, is with federal money. Federal money funneling through the state of West Virginia, and then West Virginia state money funneling into the college. The only way that the United States government can enforce a school desegregation movement, the only way they can make that happen is by cutting purse strings. Sure, they can send National Guardsmen to this school or that school. To really do it nationally, they have to tie up the funding. And the funding says this: if you cannot meet a certain standard of integration, then you cannot receive federal money. It's that simple. Storer College, from its inception, had been open to anyone. Any race, any sex, any creed, anything. But you are in segregated West Virginia. Which means that when I open a school to anybody in the 19th century and keep it open that long, the only students it's ever going to attract are black students. We're an HBCU, but we weren't intended to be. We were an HBCU because of how culture forced us to be here. And then culture forces this place to die. The last graduating class is 1955. 1 year. Disappears. No white student would come here. They can't meet the integration standards, and they evaporate. Other schools persisted. I mean, right down the road here, we've got Howard in DC, which is one of the preeminent HBCUs in the country. And what makes them different than us? They socked away some cash. Because they lost their federal funding too. Because they didn't meet that integration standard, but they're a private university that had enough in the endowment to weather the storm. They grabbed onto the black middle class and said, help us. And Storer College had that chance too. Over in this case, and like I said, I love the fact that I can geek out over this stuff. Over in this case, if you look in the center here, in 1931, the same year that Pearl Tatton stood up, a man came here from Harlem and wrote this piece of paper for Storer College. Youth, we have tomorrow bright before us, like a flame. Yesterday, a night gone thing, a sundown name. And dawn today, broad arc above, the road we came, we march. Langston Hughes. The school was connected. It could have survived. But tiny bad decisions add up. And that's the thing I want to leave you with. We can do questions and wander around more and look at all the cool stuff. You can ask me about anything in the building. But really, the idea at the center of this are those last two words that Langston Hughes wrote on this copy of the poem. And what I love about that is that this is his poem, Youth. And it's longer than that. It doesn't end there. But this copy ends on two words. We march. We march. What in your life do you need to march for? What in your life is worth marching for? What in your life is worth saving? Where's your Storer College? Where's the place that you need to step up and say, no, not today? Because that's what this place is. And if it hadn't been for a few bum decisions and a few folks that didn't have their voices listened to, this place might still be going. And I wouldn't have a job. And I would be so happy about that. The Park Service took over in the 1960s, and we made a training center out of the place. It's abandoned property, and the federal government took it back over. Gutted it, except for little bits here and there that are still the historic fabric. and turned it into a training center. So we still have that legacy of education here. There's one more person I want to introduce you to. And to introduce you to him, I have to walk you through a certain door. So, Storer College students for commencement, they had a baccalaureate and a chapel service. It's a religious institution after all. Free Will Baptists, they gotta get their say in there. They'd walk out of this building in their attire, walk out the front door, down the path and over to the church. Then they'd walk back for the final commencement. So I know that every single person that graduated from Storer College walked through one particular door. And I want to walk through that door now.
Yes, my favorite part. This is my Facebook
How many of you are history geeks? It's okay. You're in a safe place. I'm a history geek. And history geeks end up loving places and loving people. And having favorite places and having favorite people. And there are literally hundreds of people, thousands of people that walk through that door. Some of them graduated. Some of them didn't. Some of them came here just to get a leg up over a one-room schoolhouse. And actually, that's my favorite person from Storer College. He didn't graduate. He came through that door. He walked inside. He's been about 2 years here. He went to a Martinsburg one-room schoolhouse, segregated. This is in the 19-teens. He got a really shitty education. He would have told you that's exactly what he got there. In fact, he would have told you that what he got here wasn't that great an education either. At that point in time, Storer College is really only able to give their students a high school level education because they have been deprived of education at the lower level for so long. That's as far as you can get folks in the time they're here. But Louis King wants to go further. He wants to aim higher. So Louis King comes here for 2 years, does his college prep work, and then leaves, and goes down to D.C., goes down to Howard. He spends 4 years at Howard, and he gets his bachelor's degree. And when he's at Howard, he finds an amazing field of study that he loves completely, anthropology. Louis Eugene King is a born anthropologist. He loves to study people. He loves to study how human beings interact with one another. Who they are, what's in their soul, why do they use this pot, why do they study these things, why are they obsessed with that movie? That's who he is. That's who I am too. So I'm kind of geeking out over him because he feels like me. I feel like him. He goes to Howard. He does good at Howard. Does so well that he gets accepted to a PhD program at Columbia University in New York City. Goes to Columbia, and he studies with some of the preeminent anthropologists in the entire field, and they are breaking new ground. You see, before this point, when we talk about anthropology studying people, we were talking about studying dead people, okay? We're talking about studying people that left behind junk underground. We're talking about basically archaeologists that dig up pots and go, okay, what did this pot mean? Who were the Egyptians? What about these dead people? Louis King is on the cutting edge of anthropology where he says, we don't just study dead people, we study living people. And they're a hell of a lot easier to study. He comes back home and he does his PhD thesis in the Martinsburg area. He studies the same exact schools that he came up in. He He studies the one-room black schoolhouses. He's trying to figure out the quality of Negro education in rural West Virginia. And that's what he writes his PhD thesis on. And he submits it. He puts it in an envelope, and he hands it into Columbia, and they say, where's the rest? He goes, what do you mean, where's the rest? Columbia had a requirement at that point in time. You had to submit 27 typewritten copies of your PhD thesis in order to graduate. By this point, Louis King, who grew up poor, an immigrant from Barbados, whose parents died while he was still on the island, and moved to America because it's where his only living relative, his sister, was, and she became his mother. This kid of immigrants, of forced immigration, who now has a wife and two kids, doesn't have enough cash to hire a typist. He never graduates from Columbia. His PhD is withheld from him because of his economic status, and his economic status comes to him because of the color of his skin. And then the Great Depression hits, and everybody's out of work, not just him. And down in DC, they start putting together relief programs, and one of those is the Civilian Conservation Corps. There's a man down in DC that works for the Department of the Interior, his name is Clark Foreman. He went into the head of the CCC and says, listen, we've got CCC camps where there are white officers and black enlisted. Why don't we have any black officers in the CCC? You know, why don't we have any black officers over those black enlisted men, or black officers over white enlisted men? And the head of the CCC says, wait. You don't know how that's going to go over. Listen, you don't know how people are going to react to that. And Clark Foreman says, boy, I grew up in Atlanta. You don't know that it's going to be okay. Head of the CCC says, no. Can't do it. And Clark Foreman needles him and pushes him and prods him. And finally, to get him to shut up, he says, fine, Foreman, do whatever you want in any CCC camp that's on Department of the Interior property. All those CCC camps that are national parks, do whatever the hell you want with those. Foreman goes back to his office. Now think about this. It's the 1930s, and the Department of the Interior has an Office of Negro Affairs. Extremely forward-thinking for that moment. He goes back to his office and says, okay, the next position that comes open in a CCC camp for an officer in a national park, we are filling with a qualified black candidate. No holds barred, we are doing it. The next position that comes open, the historian of Gettysburg National Military Park. And Clark Foreman goes, well, shit. And that's not in his oral history, but from the rest of the language he uses in his oral history, I have to assume that that's exactly what he says. Well, shit. Where do I find a credentialed historian who's black, out of work, during the Great Depression, to fill this position? Louis Eugene King. I'm a park ranger. And we created, in this college, the man who broke the professional color line in the National Park Service. Louis Eugene King becomes the first black officer in the Civilian Conservation Corps and leads black men in the preservation of the battlefield where freedom was won. Where Lincoln said, we here highly resolved that these dead shall not have died in vain. They reset the stones in the cemetery. They rebuild stone walls across the battlefield. They clean up monuments. They make the place look spiffy for the 75th anniversary. And then they lay the foundation under his guidance for the Eternal Light Peace Memorial. World War II comes along and Louis Eugene King gets fired. They run out of cash. And even though there was a guy that had less seniority, he was white. We're not a perfect agency after all. You saw that over there. But for just one fleeting moment, we showed that we can step forward. And that's what we need to do. Keep marching. King marched for the rest of his life. Louis King led the black Boy Scout troop because the whites wouldn't let any black boys in to become Eagle Scouts. He spoke in the cemetery in Gettysburg year after year about how voting rights needed to be ensured across the country. He kept agitating and pushing and pushing. He kept marching. So I want you to take the spirit of this place, shove it down inside your heart, and use it to propel you forward. Heal whatever wound you need to in society. Thank you guys for coming out.
Thank you.